Okay, so we'll begin. The speaker today is Sandip Trivedi, and he will talk about entanglement, entropy, and gauge theories.
Okay, well, good morning, everybody. I feel, I don't know, all strapped up here. Also, it's being recorded, which adds to the pressure. let me begin by thanking the organizers for inviting me and giving me the opportunity to give this talk. And especially nice to be talking at the ICTS, of course. Today is something of a birthday, I learned, and we'll have more of that later on in the day. So a special privilege to be here, and also to be here in this meeting, which brings together people from different communities and gives me a chance to meet friends who I don't meet on my normal circuit of talks. Okay, so the title is Entanglement, Entropy, and Gauge Theories. There is no watch in this room, I guess, so that's a bit of a worry, but or I can use my mobile phone. But I should keep track, about 10:28, okay. Oh, there's a clock on that, I see. Okay, I'll try to keep track here. And well, I didn't know that the organizers will be so generous as to say it's a talk which can extend to 2 hours. I mean, that kind of generosity is not seen most places, and I'm not sure the audience is prepared for that. So I have roughly a 1 hour kind of talk, actually even a little shorter, but then if you like, we can have more discussion and perhaps some of you would, in fact, like to come up to the board, so. Okay, all right. Okay, sure. And that'll be great. So we don't have to be very formal. Okay, so let's see. Here, I think this will work. So what I'll describe to you, the work I'll describe to you was done with two students, Sudeep Ghosh, who's actually now at the ICTS, and somewhere here in the audience, here he is, and Ronak Soni, my student, who's also here in the audience, and that's great because both of them will answer all the hard questions. I just get to stand up and give the talk. but this is actually a topic where there's been quite a lot of work. Of course, the subject of entanglement, as you all know, has excited much interest recently, and in fact, is a subject that is well suited for bringing field theorists, string theorists, and condensed matter theorists together because it interests all of them. But insofar as gauge theories are concerned, which will be the topic for my talk, I'll just list a few key papers. The very important paper by Cassini, Huerta, and Rosabal, thinking about things in a very algebraic point of view. And for me, this paper was very difficult to understand. It's written in very sophisticated language, of operators and algebras and so on that I'm not used to. But in attempting to decode it, we sort of got going and then did things somewhat in a simple-minded way, which I want to tell you about. So this paper, I should mention, a nice work by Giorgio Radicevich, who's a graduate student at Stanford, done a nice work. One paper by a Japanese group, Aoki et al. I think they have one more. Since then, important paper by Biudovich and Polikarpov with some of the same ideas that I will discuss. Several papers by Donnelly and Wall and so on the topic. Nice work by Senthil and Pretko, which is also on this subject, came out recently. A paper by Akolin et al., which ties in with the second paper we wrote especially. A more recent paper of Cassini and Huerta, 1512, just a week or so ago, and so on. So quite a lot of activity in this general area. Okay, well, I'll start with an introduction. I'll try to tell you what is entanglement and why it's of interest, but why it's more subtle to define it when we come to gauge theories as opposed to, say, spin systems, which have obviously local degrees. So we'll start with that introduction. I'll then tell you the definition we proposed and also others have discussed, which I'll call the extended Hilbert space definition. I'll illustrate it in the case of a Z2 gauge theory on the lattice, and most of my discussion will be about this case. Extending from Z2 to any abelian gauge theory does not add that much, okay, is straightforward. The non-abelian case does introduce new elements, and to illustrate that, we'll talk about an SU2 gauge theory on the lattice. Also, just to keep things simple, I won't introduce matter in this discussion, but the definition is actually very straightforward to extend also with matter. Then we'll discuss some of the properties of this definition, which makes it an attractive one, I think. Then how to characterize the resulting answer or the definition in gauge invariant terms, in terms of gauge invariant data of the theory. Discuss connections with the replica trick. Discuss the toric code as an example where you can actually use the definition, calculate an answer, and the answer you get is useful and interesting. So we'll discuss that because it's a very simple example to keep in mind. Then we'll turn to something else. A definition, after all, it might be attractive, so unuseful, but in the end is a definition, and in physics we often like to understand things in operational terms. And in quantum information theory, of course, they've been thinking about entanglement as well, and they like to define entanglement in an operational way. They like to carry out a measurement on a bipartite system, a system which has two parts with some entanglement between the two parts, carry out certain operations, and use those operations to then define an operational measure of entanglement. And we'll discuss that towards the end of the talk. And what you'll see is that the definition I'm giving does not coincide with what you can extract in an operational way, as per these definitions, from the entanglement. So the operational definition will be different from this extended Hilbert space definition that I'll give you. And I think this is a general feature of gauge theories. The fact that gauge theories have, physically speaking, extended non-local excitations like Wilson lines or electric flux tubes, in the end, I think manifests itself in this fact that what you can extract is not always the most natural thing you can define. So I think this is a very interesting general feature, and I'm not sure how much time I'll have, but let me at least mention it and we can talk about it. Also, I'm not exactly an expert on quantum information theory and so on, so I'll tell you my limited understanding of all this. And then we'll end with some conclusions. Okay, and please. Okay, that's an interesting question. Let me come back to that in a minute, but say that in general, the relation between the entanglement we define and duality is an interesting one. A simpler question is, if I take 2 plus 1D gauge systems, they are often dual to spin systems. And in spin systems, it's conceptually much clearer to think of entanglement because the degrees of freedom are obviously local. And so you would say, all right, the definition one gives in the gauge theory, is it equivalent to the definition in the dual spin system? And the answer is that it's not so obvious. Because what happens is duality is not a local change of variables on the lattice. There is a slightly non-local aspect to it. So the question of entanglement, which is what is the entanglement of some localized region with the rest, doesn't obviously map under duality. Nevertheless, it should be the case. For example, suppose we take a continuum limit. You might think that this extent of non-locality is only at the lattice scale. So in the end, the continuum answer should match between the two dual systems. And I think that should happen, but it's not been investigated well enough because the whole subject of defining entanglement for gauge theory is a little bit new. But I think that's the kind of physical check one would like to have. No, I think those two definitions will be different, I think, what you can measure. But I think once we understand the kind of definition I'm giving here, that should match. And you may ask, why should that be the case? And that's because, as I will try to discuss, the definition I give, we will be able to map to a replica trick path integral. And then in the replica trick path integral, you should be able to do a duality change of variables to go over to a path integral, say, starting from gauge variables to spin variables. And as long as you regulate the determinants and so on and understand the UV divergences and so on well, then the finite paths, which are well defined in the continuum, should match. No. So it will match for the replica trick calculation, which agrees with our definition, but will not match in general for what you can measure. I don't know. I'm not fully sure. That sounds. Oh, I see. Yeah, it could. I don't know. You're right. I haven't fully understood the continuum version of this mismatch. Is part of why I'm so hesitant to answer that question. You're right. Of course, physically speaking, you're right. It should match. Yeah, in the other side, there should be no such distinction. Okay, maybe they match. I'm sorry, I'm giving a slightly garbled. Here I'm clearer how to proceed in terms of establishing the connection. I think what, in the simpler cases we have analyzed, which don't have continuum limits, like toric codes, when you extract the answer which is independent of cutoff, say measured in the topological entanglement entropy, then you find that had you used a definition of entanglement in the so the topological entanglement entropy, we'll come to this, is built out of the entanglement entropy in some clever way to be independent of cutoffs. And if you use the definition of entanglement which corresponds to what you can actually extract or measure, then you don't get, quote unquote, the correct answer or a useful answer. And so there is a cutoff independent quantity where a mismatch persists. What happens in the duality, I'm not fully sure. Yeah, Rona?
The UN, thank you. And what they find is that the universal part does match across the duality. But in the UN case, it's not measurable, whereas in the scalar field case, it is measurable. In the sense of Sandip will speak about.
But then, of course, Ashok would come back and say, what's measurable should be independent or duality frame. And so that's why I don't say that. So please. Yeah. Well, I'm coming. I'm coming to that. Let me define a gauge theory, and then let's come back to some of these questions. Okay, so all right, I have something of an introduction, which is only three transparencies, but I thought maybe I should try to give something, so here we go. Entanglement has emerged as an important way to quantify quantum correlations, and in a sense, quantify the essential weirdness of quantum mechanics. Gauge theories are central to our understanding of particle physics, condensed matter physics, and gravity, and so, of course, it's a good idea, I think, to think about entanglement in gauge theories. So it's therefore worth trying to give a precise definition of entanglement entropy in gauge theories. And since, you know, this is a forum to bring people together, let me say from the gravity point of view, actually some of the recent excitement is because there's a growing feeling that entanglement might hold the key to the understanding of how space-time emerges, how smooth space-time emerges. This is partly because when you ask questions about entanglement in a field theory on the dual gravity side, then they map to very geometrical questions. For example, the entanglement entropy corresponds to the area of an extremal surface, of a, let's say, minimal area surface, and that, of course, minimal area, of course, cares about geometry. So questions about entanglement map on the gravity side naturally to questions about geometry, and that has led to the feeling that perhaps if you understand entanglement very deeply, you might understand then why in some systems space-time, a smooth space-time can emerge. And also in terms of ideas from condensed matter physics, since the topic is ideas in field theory which something owe themselves to condensed matter physics, or something like that. I think one very significant thing is that variational techniques which have been developed on the condensed matter side, whose key feature, from what little I understand, is that they keep track of entanglement carefully to try and understand the resulting spectrum of the Hamiltonian, et cetera, These variational techniques then perhaps could also be could play a key role in understanding more deeply ADS-CFT. And so that's why people on the gravity side are interested in these developments. Okay, now in a system with local degrees of freedom, the entanglement entropy is straightforward to define. Okay, so let's take a simple example. Let's work in two spatial dimensions on the lattice and take a Z2 spin system. That means at every vertex of this lattice, you have what's called a single qubit, a two-state system, up or down. Okay, that's the Z2 spin system. You all know about it. Now, in such a system, it's very straightforward how to define the entanglement. That's because at every vertex, you have a two-dimensional Hilbert space, which I'll call HI. I labels the vertex, the site. And the full Hilbert space of the system, then, is nothing but the tensor product of the Hilbert spaces on all the sides. Okay. Now, if you're interested in entanglement between some subset of spins and the rest, I'll call the subset of spins the inside, sorry, although it may not be geometrically some connected region, even just some set of spins, the inside with the rest, the outside. So, for example, it could be two of these spins with the rest, okay? Then all you do, since the Hilbert space has a tensor product form, all you do, you can write the Hilbert space also as H in times tensor product H out, where H in is the Hilbert space of all the vertices or sites in the inside. Okay, and then you simply trace out over the out Hilbert space. You take your state, let's say it's a pure state, which is what we'll be interested in. You trace out over the outside degrees of freedom, construct a density matrix, and then from that density matrix, you compute the von Neumann entropy minus trace rho log rho, and that is the definition, if you like, of entanglement entropy. Okay, so conceptually, very straightforward how to go about it, even though calculationally sometimes it might be a little difficult. Okay, and the key here is that the Hilbert space we started with had a tensor product decomposition, and in particular, a tensor product decomposition between the inside degrees of freedom and the outside. Okay, that's what made it conceptually so straightforward. So now, let's come to a gauge theory. And I'll define a Z2 gauge theory precisely for you. But the essence will be that it's not as straightforward to define entanglement because there are non-local degrees of freedom, for example, Wilson loops or loops of electric flux, as I said. And because these are non-local, the Hilbert space of physical states or gauge invariant states does not admit, will not admit, we'll see a tensor product decomposition between the inside and the outside degrees of freedom. Okay? And this lack of a obvious tensor product decomposition is what makes then the definition of entanglement somewhat subtle in gauge theories. Okay, so keep that in mind. Now we'll move towards defining the gauge theory, a simple example precisely. I'll work in lattice gauge theory because entanglement is inherently divergent, as many of you know, so it's best to work on the lattice where everything is regulated. And I'll work in the Hamiltonian framework where time is continuous, but space is not. So it's a spatial lattice with continuous time. And just because I can't draw in more than two dimensions, we'll work in 2+1 dimensions. Okay, so the spatial lattice will be, and we'll just take it to be a planar lattice for simplicity. But everything generalizes to higher dimensions and so on. So that won't be an intrinsic limitation. Okay, so now let's consider a Z2 gauge theory. Here is the spatial lattice. But now, as opposed to the spin system, the degrees of freedom live on links. So they live on these links here. And each of them is Z2 valued. So you have one qubit worth of a degree of degrees of freedom on each link now. Okay? So one qubit worth. And if you like, I can choose them to be eigenstates of sigma 3. Another operator which will be very important is sigma 1, which flips the spin. And you'll see that sigma 1 will play the role of electric flux, the analog of electric flux in the Z2 theory. Okay, so that's the system. I'll define gauge invariance for you. But for now, let me at least note that to begin with, on each of these links, you have, again, a two-dimensional Hilbert space, one qubit worth. And we label a link by I and j, the vertex from which it begins and ends. and correspondingly the Hilbert spaces Hij. Okay, now gauge transformations. So the degrees of freedom live on links, but gauge transformations, which are a very important property in gauge theories, are defined on vertices. Okay, so let Vi be a vertex, then the gauge transformation in the Z2 theory on the Vi vertex is generated by the product of all the sigma 1 operators for all the links which start from the ith vertex and go to an adjacent vertex, the j vertex. Okay, so for example, if I'm interested in the gauge transformations on this vertex, I take the four links which leave it, and I take the product of sigma 1 on all the four links, and that product defines an operator which acts on states in this Hilbert space, and that operator is what I call a gauge transformation at this vertex. Okay, so, excuse me? Oh, sorry, you're right. The product is over all links, you're right, ij, but in effect only over j, so all j adjacent to the vertex I, that's right. Okay, and now physical states, and this is the important constraint in a gauge theory, are defined to be only those states which are invariant with respect to gauge transformations. That means g of vi acting on psi for any physical state psi must give you psi for all vertices I. Okay, so this is the requirement which must be met for a state to be physical. And this requirement is actually the analog in the Z2 theory of Gauss's law. We are actually working, if you like, if you think of sort of a continuum theory and then going on the lattice, in A0 equal to 0 gauge. And in that gauge, we now have the Hamiltonian description. And we have to impose, in addition, Gauss's law to get physical states. And this is that requirement in the Z2 gauge theory. Okay, so this is our theory. Again, vertex and four links and Gauss's law defined for all of them. Okay, physical operator, so that was physical states must be gauge invariant. Physical operators must be gauge invariant, which means G O hat, G dagger should give you back O hat for a physical operator O hat or gauge invariant operator. And two important examples to keep in mind are Wilson loops, which are the product of sigma 3, I said around any closed loop. So for example, here I could take a loop like this around the elementary plaquette, take the product of sigma 3 on these four links. You can easily convince yourself that that is invariant under the gauge transformations. Or you can take any other big loop which is closed, and what you get is, again, a gauge invariant operator. So that's one example. Another example is sigma 1 itself on every link, on any link rather. Because remember, G is generated by sigma 1 itself. So of course, it commutes with sigma 1. And therefore, this operator for any link is going to be gauge invariant. And this operator then, as I said, is the analog of electric flux. It measures the electric flux along this link in the Z2 gauge theory. Okay, so this is pretty much all you really need to know about the theory. And now let's go ahead and ask about entanglement in this theory. So here the physical degrees of freedom live on links. So the question we are interested in is, we choose some set of links. And again, actually, they don't have to form a connected region, etc. But just for simplicity, suppose you're interested in the links which lie inside this rectangular region and on the surface. So I've shown the links of interest, which I'll call the inside links by definition, in solid here. And the rest of the links I've drawn in dashed here. Okay? And the question we are interested in then is, what is the entanglement of these inside links shown in solid with the rest, which are shown in dashed as dashed here? Okay, so that's the question. We have some state. It could be any state in this theory, but it should be a physical state, gauge invariant state, and we are interested in how entangled it is. What is the entanglement of the inside with the outside? Okay, so that's the question. And the definition applies to a general set of links and so on. The question is well posed in general. Now, why is it so subtle compared to the spin system? The essential reason is I told you in a physical way was because you have these physical non-local excitations, but from a slightly more formal, or if you like, mathematical point of view, the essential obstacle comes or subtlety comes from Gauss's law that has to be imposed on every vertex for a physical state. So let's in particular look at a boundary vertex. So what I mean by a boundary vertex, and I'll use this terminology as we go along, where some of the links terminating on the vertex lie in the inside set, so they are drawn in bold, and some terminating on it are drawn in dashed, so they lie on the outside. Okay, such a vertex I'll call a boundary vertex, as opposed to say a vertex which is securely inside because all the links ending on it lie on the in the inside set, or a vertex which is securely outside because all the links ending on it lie on the outside. Okay, so let's look at a boundary vertex and see what is the constraint that Gauss's law imposes on this boundary vertex. Well, I've drawn it here where blue, let's say now, are the inside links and red the outside. Well, what Gauss's law tells you is that sigma 1 for 1, 1, the vertex, the link going from this vertex I've labeled as 1. Sorry, let me go back. Sorry, that was bad notation. Sigma 1 there is the first poly matrix as opposed to sigma 3. 1 is the first link, 2 is the second link, and so on. I'm now labeling links by just one number. Forgive me for this. So the first link is this one, the second link is this one. So the poly matrix sigma 1 along the link 4 times that along link 3 should equal that along link 1 times that along link 2. Okay, so there's a constraint like that. I had written it earlier as the product of 4 poly matrices being 1 on a physical state, but since the poly matrix is square to 1, I can equivalently write it in this form. Okay, on any physical state then, the total electric flux, which, if you like, goes in from here, must be the electric flux that goes out from that vertex. All right, we have a theory, physically speaking, with no charged matter, and lines of flux must be conserved by Gauss's law, and that constraint takes this form here. Okay, now, what this means is that the state of the links on the inside and the outside, when you're thinking of any physical state, are not independent. You see, because this constraint, which is the constraint on the state of the inside and outside links, must be met. It actually, just for stating the constraint, it doesn't matter. Here I've taken a corner vertex, but if I had taken a vertex like this, where there are 3 links on the inside and 1 on the outside, then you would have had a Gauss law constraint, but it would have been the product of, say, these 3 sigma 1 matrices equal to this sigma 1 matrix. So there's still a constraint, but the form of the constraint is different depending on whether it's how many links from the inside and outside meet at the vertex. That's not very relevant for what I'm describing, the essential point as to why this is. Sigma 1 will square to 1, but in this case, it'll be the product of 3 sigma 1 matrices equal to, you can always write it as the product of all 4 sigma matrices ending on the link equal to 1. Okay. All right. So, No, that's right. On every physical gauge invariant state, that should be the same. That's really what I meant. Maybe I should have written psi equal to that. So, yeah. Okay, so thus the Hilbert space of gauge invariant states does not admit a tensor product decomposition. And this is the essential point, because if you don't have a tensor product decomposition, then it's not straightforward how to proceed, okay? Because, yeah, please. After duality, that's true. Yeah, because only the physical gauge invariant states will map under that duality. That's right. Okay, so this is the essential point, that you don't have a Hilbert space. If you look at just physical states, which admit a tensor product decomposition, and that then makes it a little subtle how to proceed in defining entanglement. So what should we do? And, you know, the way I've set it up naturally suggests a resolution, I think, which is what I will adopt for trying to define the entanglement. And it is the following. You see, the Hilbert space of physical states. I see. No, that's also a good comment. And I think my feeling is that what I'm going to define will agree, but you should tell me afterwards whether. Yeah, you could, if it were just that, the same issue would arise. But maybe what Senthil is saying is that with the matter, sometimes there's a natural UV completion, and then the answer is clear, which is perhaps what you're saying. That's right. Now, we should come back to this, and you should tell me, but I'll tell you roughly what will happen when we go to the toric code, for example, is, and I think perhaps this happens in other condensed matter systems, is that the constraint of gauge invariance is not absolute. What happens is that the low energy states are gauge invariant, but at a price in energy, you can have non-gauge invariant excitations. And if the gauge theory is emerging in that sense in the low energy sector, then the kind of definition I give is a natural one, because you automatically work in the extended Hilbert space and then come to the definition. But you should see whether what I'm describing is what you have in mind. Okay. All right. So now, how do we try to give a definition? And the idea is very simple. We go back to this extended Hilbert space, which I introduced, which is obtained by taking the tensor product of the Hilbert spaces on each link. Okay. So as I said, in this Z2 theory, is there a picture? No. Okay. In this Z2 gauge theory, just to remind you, on every link there is a 1 qubit worth of a Hilbert space. You can take the tensor product of all those Hilbert spaces to get an extended Hilbert space. This includes in general states. This is extended because it includes in general states which don't meet the Gauss law constraint, okay? But nevertheless, this Hilbert space is available. So let's actually consider this Hilbert space. Now the advantage of this is that the extended Hilbert space, of course, admits a tensor product decomposition. If I'm interested in some subset of links, the solid ones, I can take the Hilbert space obtained by taking the tensor product of all the inside Hilbert spaces, call that the inside Hilbert space, similarly the outside Hilbert space, then the full extended Hilbert space will be the tensor product of the inside and the outside Hilbert spaces. So it admits, just by construction, a tensor product decomposition. So H in is the tensor product over Hij, where I and J lie inside, similarly H out, and it's clearly the case that H, the extended Hilbert space, is the tensor product, okay? So, no, I'm not allowing electric charges. I'm simply saying take the state which is gauge invariant, but regard it now, embed it in a way which I'll define in a precise way in the extended Hilbert space. With so it's true. In general, there can be states in the extended Hilbert space which violate Gauss's law, but the particular state we will be interested in, yeah. So in that sense, you're right that the extended Hilbert space won't require Gauss's law to be holding at any vertex, not only at the boundary, but anywhere. As charges. Okay, if you want to put it that way, that's true. That's true. All right. Yeah, please. This. Okay. Yeah, sure. You know, if you took one of these links and you took it to be in an eigenstate of sigma 1 with eigenvalue plus 1, and all the other. Oh, sorry, let's take one of the links and take it to be an eigenstate of sigma 1 with eigenvalue minus 1, and all the other links to be eigenvalue plus 1, then that's a state which is there in the extended Hilbert space, but it's not a gauge invariant state, right? Because the product of, so suppose this one was minus 1, then the product of the four links, values of sigma 1 on the four links would be minus 1. Okay, so that's an example of a gauge non-invariant state which is present in H. On the other hand, if I took a state where sigma 1 took the value plus 1 on every link in the lattice, then that would be a gauge invariant state. No, you could. Yeah, you could, you know, you could have even number of pluses and minuses at every vertex, or an odd number if you want to violate Gauss's law, and so on. Well, if the state changes under Gauss's law, then it's not invariant under Gauss's law. So then it's not physical. No. I think what was being said was, suppose two of these were plus 1 and two were minus 1. Then you would meet Gauss's law here. Now you'd have to worry about the minus 1's ending somewhere and what happens there. But there again, you know, you could have some links minus 1 so that at each vertex you continue to hold Gauss's law. It's basically like electric flux. You know, the electric, let's say the minus 1 is non-trivial electric flux. Then you have some electric flux emanating from here. It should consistently go somewhere else and so on. As long as you have closed loops of electric flux, it'll be okay. Yeah, okay. For example, if it weren't and you summed over all the gauge transformations, that would be gauge. Yeah, if you want to think about it like that, and you say that the violation of Gauss's law is because you have charged matter, then you would say you'd have some charge there, right? You could think of it like that if you like. Okay, but okay. So let's go on. So all right. So there is this natural extended Hilbert space, and it admits a tensor product decomposition. And so what we will do is take our gauge invariant state, but now regard it as a state in the extended Hilbert space. This state is gauge invariant, so it belongs to the restricted subset of gauge invariant states. But you can always embed it, and I'll show you that in a moment, unambiguously in the full extended Hilbert space. Once you do that, then it's like any other state in the Hilbert space, which admits a tensor product decomposition. You can trace out over the out Hilbert space to define a density matrix for the inside region, and from that density matrix, then compute the von Neumann entropy, taking the trace here over the inside Hilbert space to give you the entanglement entropy. Okay? And if you wanted Rene entropies, which are trace of rho to the power n for n bigger than 1, then you can similarly Once you have the density matrix, take the trace of rho to the n in the inside Hilbert space and compute the Rene entropies. So this is the basic idea, and you see it's very simple, almost childishly simple in its thinking. So this is an excellent question. So now one of our worries will be, all right, you define the density matrix by working in the extended Hilbert space, which includes non-gauge invariant states. Is the resulting definition gauge invariant? Okay, and I'll give you first an abstract argument why it is, but then we won't be satisfied with this. We will explicitly express the result in gauge invariant terms. And that's actually something important which we'll come to. No, the whole contribution will be from gauge invariant data, but it'll organize itself in a sort of interesting way, where again Gauss's law will come back in the resulting answer. But it'll be finally a fully gauge invariant answer. It won't change, say, depending on which gauge you choose and so on, for example. Okay, so the first thing I want to say is that the definition is unambiguous. Because psi gives rise to a unique state in the extended Hilbert space as follows. The gauge invariant set of states is a subset of the full extended Hilbert space, but more correctly, the full extended Hilbert space admits a decomposition as a sum over edge gauge invariant and its orthogonal complement. Okay, this is the set of all states which are orthogonal to the gauge invariant states. And then given a state psi in edge gauge invariant, you can get a state in H in a unique way by simply saying that psi has no component along the orthogonal complement. Okay, so this is a very geometrical way. It's as if you had a plane and an extra vector, you know, in a three-dimensional vector space, say, and you have a vector originally defined in the plane. You want to, you know, now regard it as a three-dimensional vector, and you say, oh, it just has no component along the z-direction. Okay, that's a completely basis-independent we have specified.
Sorry, Sandip, I have a question. In the way you set it up, maybe the extended Hilbert space is obvious, but going back to Ashok's question, in general, if I give you a gauge theory and some Hilbert space, there may be many different extended Hilbert spaces in which you could embed it, right, depending on the choice of gauge group that you used, which is not... how does one choose this extended Hilbert space? Maybe once it's given the embedding is unique, but how does one choose it in the first place? How does one construct it?
This is also a good question. At least what I'm saying is I've given you a precise extended Hilbert space on the lattice, and using that extended Hilbert space, there's an unambiguous answer. Now, someone else might come up with another way to extend Hilbert and could get another answer, and then you'd have to ask, are they physically the same or not? Within the context of the kind of constructions I'm doing themselves, this question actually becomes a little sharper when you come to the non-abelian case. But in the abelian case, roughly speaking, you know, most definitions would give you this or some part of the definition I'm going to give you, as you'll see. And that is related to the fact that not everything, the full answer we get is not physically extractable. So other people might say you use a more operational definition, and that is unambiguous, and that gives you a different. So you're right, a definition can be, different people can give different definitions. That's part of the motivation to ask physically how much is extractable and so on. But at least using this lattice and the extended Hilbert space, this is pretty unambiguous. Yes. Yes. It should be much more insensitive. It should be much more insensitive, but it's not totally insensitive. For example, if you try to use one of these definitions about how much is extractable, you actually get a different answer for even this topological part, the part which remains in the continuum limit. You don't get locked to, you get zero if you use a suitable definition that the extractable people would like.
Yes, sir.
You could think about a procedure like that, but what I want to say is, even without any average, the answer we'll get is actually gauge invariant. Right. Right, so if something was gauge variant, then you can get the gauge invariant part like this. But here, actually, even though it seems I'm using a gauge invariant extended Hilbert space, you'll see in the end, because of this central fact that all the gauge non-invariant states are orthogonal to the gauge because of the fact that the gauge dependent states are orthogonal to the gauge invariant ones, there won't be any gauge dependence left in the ultimate entanglement or Rene entropies. I see. Right. I up to issues of convergence, I think that's correct. That's correct. The final answer will be a sum over various sectors if there's a subtlety which comes in there. But you're right. At least prima facie, it does extend in that case. Those cases too. Please. Yeah. So this is one of these dualities, is it? I'm sorry, I'm not as well versed. Massive thing and sign garden, yeah. The physical expectation would be that up to regulator dependent terms, if there is a physical contribution, it should agree. The universal part should agree. And the simplest way to say it is, let's say there's a replica, here's one dumb way to say it. Let's say I can compute the entanglement by doing a path integral, one of these replica trick path integrals. Then I can change variables from the thing to the sine cordon in the path integral. And if the equivalence holds for that path integral, I should get the same answer. And the reason why it's a little subtle is that these are path integrals for the replica trick on singular manifolds, because where you get a branched cover, it's a little bit tricky. And so the duality transformation has to be thought through carefully there. And that's the issue. But up to that, the answer would be correct. Should be the same. I think
the full density matrix should be the same, because you should be able to define
spectrum.
If you have a spectrum, the density matrix is presumably related only to the spectrum of local operators, the local operator algebra that you have. And if you can argue that the local operator algebra is isomorphic between two theories, then you should be able to define the modular Hamiltonian and the entanglement entropy and whatever you like from that, all the Rene entropies, and they should all agree. Are you worried about branch cuts in these operators, or the fact that the local operator algebra might not be isomorphic? Or massive?
Sometimes there's an issue in defining universal pieces. Is there a non-trivial universal piece at all? But if there is, then I think you would expect. The log dependence on the mass. I think in 1 plus 1D, you might think that you get a piece which is log of the mass in either cutoff units or length units or whatever, maybe cutoff units. Then that should be an independent thing. So those pieces should come out right, I think. So, all right, so that's the definition. It's unambiguous because psi is unambiguously embedded. And once you have an unambiguous state in H, then the entire procedure of just computing the trace to get rho and the entanglement entropy are unambiguous. So the definition is unambiguous. Moreover, you can show that the density matrix you get in this way, even though you traced over gauge non-invariant states, computes the correct expectation value for any gauge invariant operator, okay, when you use it. And this is a very simple check to do. And the physical reason for that is you compute a expectation value by taking a trace of O hat rho in the inside Hilbert space, and then you translate everything back to what you did in the extended Hilbert space. But because, again, all gauge non-invariant states are orthogonal to psi, only the gauge invariant states in the full system contribute. And so this can be written as a trace in the gauge invariant Hilbert space of O psi psi. Okay, and so so that is ensure that this quantity is the same as the trace of H gauge invariant O hat psi psi, which is the correct value for any expectation value. So that's just a bit of algebra, but that tells you that the density matrix you get is a sensible one. What are some of the other nice properties?
Cross the links inside and outside.
We are going to come to that. I will characterize the gauge. I'm just giving an abstract argument here, but we'll give a very explicit form of the density matrix in terms of gauge invariant data. And there what you will show is, and the answer, just to tell you, will be decomposed into a set of sectors. And operators which cut across the boundary will let you go from one sector to another. So that will be the. Okay, now there are also various nice properties that this definition has. They all stem from the underlying fact that the Hilbert space on each link has a natural inner product which is meets all the various positivity conditions, because this is the each link variable is a Z2 valued qubit, which the natural inner product on a qubit, okay? So it meets all the positivity conditions. From that, you know that H has various nice positivity conditions, and that allows you to prove, for example, that the entanglement you've defined meets, for example, the strong subadditivity condition. This is a condition often talked about. If you have A, B, and C, three subsets of the full system, in our case, three sets of links, just to keep things simple, let's not make them share any links in common, then S of A union B plus S of B union C is greater than or equal to A union B union C plus S of B. This is some standard inequality, one of the nice properties you want out of a definition, and that is indeed met. Okay, now, how am I doing in terms of time? I'm very slow, so. Oh, God. I don't think I should talk all the time. So, well, maybe, but give is half an hour all right? Will I overshoot? I don't know, I'm very slow, I'm sorry. I don't, let me, okay, let me see. I don't have to get to the end of the talk. So, now, okay, it was gauge. I said it's gauge invariant in this abstract way because I didn't have to choose any gauge. Any gauge invariant state has a unique embedding in the extended Hilbert space, and the definition then is unambiguous. But let's try to understand in a, and soon we'll try to understand, as I said, more explicitly the gauge invariance. But before that, let me just say that because the definition is so simple, it generalizes to any theory, any gauge theory. Okay, if you went from Z2 to U1, the link variable is an angle, but so what? Each link Hilbert space, you take the tensor product of all of them, you get a tensor product Hilbert space, which is the extended one. You can embed a gauge invariant state in that Hilbert space and take the traces and get an entanglement entropy. Same if it's SU2, then you have two-dimensional matrices as link variables, it doesn't matter. If you have matter, also doesn't matter. Now you have degrees of freedom which sit on the vertices. You define your inside region as a set of links and a set of vertices. Okay, embed everything in the extended Hilbert space. Again, you have a tensor product decomposition between the inside degrees of freedom, now defined as a set of vertices with matter and a set of links with their link degrees of freedom and the rest, and you can carry out this procedure. So it just generalizes enough. Yeah, in the continuum limit, of course, you have to be more careful. But here we are on the lattice, let's say. I'm just working on the lattice, and there the strong subadditivity.
When you say strong subadditivity holds, you're talking about the pieces that would go to infinity in the continuum.
Well, I just worked on the lattice here for now, and I wasn't taking the continuum limit. But yes, in the continuum limit, each of those terms will diverge. And then if one is interested in whether the finite pieces left over satisfy it, that's a different, that's a discussion one should still have. So here it was really just for the lattice theory. I think it's not obvious because when you take the infinities out, things can become positive or negative and so on. Okay, but we'd like to understand in gauge invariant terms better what this definition is. And in particular, if it is really gauge invariant, we should be able to express it in not so abstract a way, very concretely in terms of gauge invariant data. So what does the resulting entanglement look like? And again, we'll go back to the Z2 case. And the abelian, all abelian cases are similar. And there's one new feature, non-trivial new feature, which comes in when you do the non-abelian case. And I'll allude to it. I may not be able to discuss it in full detail here. OK, so I remind you, the essential obstacle is that you don't have a tensor product decomposition of the Hilbert space of gauge invariant states. And let's now try to understand that constraint a little better. And that'll allow us to express the answer we get from the extended Hilbert space definition in gauge invariant terms. So I'll use the terminology inside vertices. Where is it? And I'll denote them by red. This is a vertex, as I said, where only inside links terminate. Here the inside links, I remind you, are shown in solid lines. So this is an inside vertex. Outside vertices will be shown in green, and their dotted links will end. That is, links on the outside will end. And boundary vertices, which could be this one or this one, will be shown in blue. And there, both some inside and some outside links terminate. Okay. And in particular, the boundary vertices will play an important role when we try to express the answer in gauge invariant terms. Okay. So now, and this is because Gauss's law actually is a non-trivial constraint essentially on the boundary vertices. All right. So let's now take Gauss's law. But think of it as follows. And since I will also have the extended Hilbert space, to begin with, let me consider a situation where, let's say, the product of sigma 1s, the full electric flux, in the dashed lines, which are the outside links, is ki, some integer. All right, I could go to eigenstates of sigma 1. Then the product of these, in this case, two sigma matrices is some integer, 0 or 1. And similarly, the product of the two sigma matrices on the inside is some other integer, ki prime. I can do this for every boundary vertex vi, OK? And in this way, I can define the total electric flux vector, if you like, which I'll denote by solid k. 1, 2, 3, 4, here is some arbitrary way to number all the boundary vertices. And k1, k2, kn are then the total electric flux going out at the vi boundary vertex, okay? And so this vector then tells you just how much electric flux vertex by vertex is going out. Similarly, ki prime is the own ingoing electric flux vector at every boundary vertex. Now, you see, because the extended Hilbert space has states which don't meet Gauss's law, in general, you can always, first of all, you can decompose the inside Hilbert space into sectors of fixed electric flux in this way. This is just because you can diagonalize the sigma 1 matrix, if you like. And similarly, you can decompose the outside Hilbert space. This is the outside, and this is the inside, into sectors of fixed ingoing electric flux in this case and outgoing electric flux in that case. So these I call HK out and HK prime in. These are sectors of out and in, respectively, with fixed electric flux denoted by vector k or k prime. And it's easy to show that the full extended Hilbert space is then a sum over the tensor products of hk out tensor product hk prime in, where the sum ranges over k and k prime in an independent way, because this is the extended Hilbert space with no Gauss law constraint. Okay. Now, and clearly, when we come to gauge invariant states, you can see that k will have to be the same as k prime. All right, because you'll impose the Gauss law constraint. But we are coming to that. Now, in addition, there's a subspace of HK out, which are a set of states which carry this flux K prime as far as the boundary vertices are concerned, and which are gauge invariant with respect to all inside gauge transformations. Okay? I'm sorry, this is of HK in. So you know, I could take a state which carries some amount of electric flux going out, and then just take it to be gauge invariant with respect to all inside gauge transformations. So this is a subset of the in Hilbert space, HK prime in. Similarly, there's HK gauge invariant out, sorry for this notation, which is a subspace of HK out, namely all states which carry this flux, outgoing flux, and a gauge invariant with respect to gauge transformation on outside vertices. Okay, so that's a bit of definition. But once you do that, you can then show that the gauge invariant set, Hilbert space, is not a tensor product between out and in. That was the essential problem. But it is can be written as a sum over tensor products, okay, where the label K is the same on two sides. That's because you've imposed Gauss's law on the boundary vertices. And what comes as far as inside is concerned is HK, gauge invariant in, because the states are gauge invariant with respect to inside vertices, gauge transformations on inside vertices, and also outside vertices, okay? So this is the nature of the Hilbert space, that it's not a tensor product, but it's a sum over tensor products, okay? So that is the essential point. When you come to non-abelian cases, there's a bit of a slight subtlety, which I'll come to, but let's just persist with the abelian case for a moment. Once you do that, it becomes clear you can write the density matrix as a sum over various sectors by tracing out the outside Hilbert space in the corresponding sector and the full density matrix, because if you sum over all the sectors, all choices of electric flux, you get the full outside Hilbert space, and only gauge invariant out states contribute because these are orthogonal to gauge non-invariant states, etc. So this is the corresponding density matrix. And once you get the density matrix in this sector, you can then compute the full entanglement entropy, which is now a sum over the different sectors. Okay, so that's the crucial thing, that then the gauge invariant Hilbert space admits this tensor product decomposition as a sum over different tensor products, and then the full answer can be written as a sum over different electric flux sectors. So the physical thing to remember is we've decomposed the problem into sectors of fixed electric flux coming in, which you specify at each boundary vertex, and then in each sector you can compute the density matrix in terms of gauge invariant data, because you start with a gauge invariant state, you take some gauge invariant subset of the full Hilbert space, gauge invariant Hilbert space, this is all gauge invariant data, and from there you can then compute the density matrix. So this is the gauge invariant characterization then, if you like, for the density matrix, but we'd like to understand it even more explicitly in gauge invariant terms. So when you take this and process it just a little bit, the resulting answer is the following. It has two pieces. There's one piece which I'm calling a classical piece, just because when we come to the more operational way to measure things by extracting things and so on, this is a piece we won't be able to extract. In that sense, it's not a quantum piece, but it very much contributes to sort of physical quantum entanglement. So maybe this is a little misleading. Anyways, just a label. There are two parts to it. There's this first piece, which involves the probabilities to be in every sector K. And these probabilities are defined as follows. I take the density matrix in that sector. I trace over the inside Hilbert space in that sector. That tells you what's the probability in this state for having some electric flux, given electric flux. And then I can take that probability out and define a normalized density matrix in this sector, which I call rho bar. So that is of unit trace. And so the final answer is made out of these two pieces, pk and rho bar k. And it follows, one is just the probability that you are in different flux sectors. Okay, that probability gives you some entropy. That's the first piece. And the second is an average over all the sectors, where you take the normalized density matrix in each sector, you compute its von Neumann entropy, and you average over the different sectors with the probability to be in that sector. So that's the answer, and this is now totally, all the data here is totally gauge invariant, so that tells you that indeed, as we have thought from general arguments, this definition is a gauge invariant one. Okay, so that is the final answer. And as I said, the crux was that the gauge invariant Hilbert space is a sum over tensor product. Okay, now the important thing is, and I won't perhaps have time to go over this in great detail, you see, the different sectors labeled by different amounts of electric flux, actually, when it comes to carrying out operations or measurements, correspond to different super selection sectors. Now, what do I mean by that? If we are going to restrict ourselves to gauge invariant operators that only act on the inside links or only act on the outside links, okay, not gauge invariant operators, for example, like Wilson loops, which go from the inside to the outside, but instead operators which act securely either inside or outside, then those operators can't change the electric flux leaving the system, vertex by vertex, okay? And therefore, they can't change because they must commute with the sigma ones and so on. And therefore, they can't change the label K, and therefore, they can't change the sectors. So if you're going to restrict yourself to gauge invariant operators completely inside or outside and build all your measurements out of them, then you're not going to be able to change these sectors, okay? And even though I won't have time to go into it perhaps in great detail, that's the underlying reason why when you operationally try to extract this entanglement, you can't extract this piece, because this is just the probability to be in each sector. You can't access it if you're fixed in one sector, if you can't change those sectors, okay? But it will turn out that you can actually extract this entire answer even after averaging over K. And I don't think we'll have time for this, but I'll at least mention that you can give protocols in the spirit in which people do things in information theory to make that precise. That's one of the things we did. If you, yeah. So the kind of thing people like to do to make entanglement operationally precise is, they say, okay, suppose you have a Bell pair. So more generally, let's take some state like this. Oh, you know. Okay, sorry. Oh. I rub this for now. Sorry. So, you know, suppose you had some, just to give you a very simple example, suppose you had some simple state made out of two qubits, and you know, let's say it's a state like this. And you want to measure how entangled is one qubit with the other. Now, of course, if P minus was zero, it's not entangled. If, on the other hand, these are 1 over root 2, it's maximally entangled. But you want to make the idea more precise for an arbitrary value of P. Then, you know, if you could do a unitary transformation on the 2-qubit Hilbert space, then, of course, you can turn any state into any other. So that's not a good way to do it. But instead, what you say is, look, I'm going to allow you to do the most general unitary transformation on either the first qubit or the second. Now, subject to this, you know, what can you do, and how can you try to measure the entanglement? So the nature of the question is such that you restrict yourself to doing either operations on one half or the other half of the system, and then you try to make this concept more precise. And when it comes to a gauge theory, then the natural thing is that you have access. So the physical thing here is you have access to one or the other half of the system, and you do all the gauge invariant operations on that. And when you try to do that, then you can't access this term. This includes operations on the links on the boundary, but in terms of operators which are gauge invariant, entirely on the inside. Yeah, so the problem here is, you know, the problem here. Well, but you know, sometimes you just have, I mean, you know, your gauge theory is what it is, right? Maybe in condensed matter, you can go and build another system which is dynamical matter, but... Well, that's not true. I mean, even condensed matter physics, you might have a system where all the charge matter is highly, highly gapped. Okay, that makes it a little fuzzier perhaps, but even there, maybe at some cost in energy, you can... But by the way, I mean, these definitions all extend in the case where you have a system with matter. I haven't described them, but then you'll have to move matter in and out. But what I was trying to say was the operational definition of entanglement becomes precise only if you don't allow the two parts of the bipartite system to talk to each other. If you do unitary operations, which allow the two parts to talk to each other, then what happens? You can turn any state into any other. So in the case of matter, we'll have to think a little bit, but my feeling is, again, there's a similar issue, that if you don't allow the matter to cross over, you know, you have some matter. So the physical idea is you have a system, you divide it into two parts, and you keep one here, and you keep one in Andromeda. You know, and then you allow unitary transformations, and basically you convert this system into a bunch of Bell pairs. And then you ask, how many Bell pairs do you get which are entangled? That's the spirit of the question. So if you don't allow degrees of freedom to cross over, then I think there'll always be these different sectors which you won't be able to go from one to the other over. If you allow yourself operators like Wilson loops which go from one to the other, then you'll be able to access everything. So, okay, we can talk more about that. Yes, full system. That in electric flux K. Yes, that's what it is. Well, what happens is if you just do. You know, from the inside, yeah. Suppose you were interested in some links, then you just. You're restricted to doing measurements using gauge invariant operators that are only defined on the inside links, then you can't access. You can't change the sectors. At least that much is clear. And physically what happens, if you can't change the sectors, you can't quite assess what is the probability to have been in that sector.
Operators that cut across the boundary are rather important. I mean, they're somehow the root of the entire difficulty. So now to say that somehow the thing that's physical is the thing that consists of gauge invariant operators that are entirely inside and entirely outside is, I'm a little worried that in some sense the thing that was new about this system was that you had these operators that could cut across the boundary. So
right.
I don't know if that's...
Because you have non-local operators, if you then restrict yourself to local measurements, which you have to make entanglement precise in an operational way, then you can't access the full entanglement. If you allow yourself non-local measurements, then you know you can convert any state into any other, which is unitarily equivalent, and every state can be made a pure state. So if you try to operationally define entanglement, you need to have a notion of local measurements. And that is in conflict with the existence of non-local observables in gauge theory.
By means of your division of the Hilbert space, didn't you basically answer this question of what you meant by local? Because in the initial situation, there was this problem that you had these open Wilson lines that could come and end on something, you know, inside your region. And then you didn't know whether to count them inside or as outside. But the moment you went to your extended Hilbert space, I thought now you have a totally unambiguous definition of what local is. And that's what you use to define entanglement. Why not stick with that definition, which would actually then give you this answer rather than trying to, you know, go back to local in the gauge invariant Hilbert space. The whole point of your extended Hilbert space was it allowed you to define local unambiguously.
It allowed you to define local unambiguously, and we are using that definition of local, namely the set of inside links, to also define local operators as those operators which act on the Hilbert space of inside links. And the only additional restriction we are saying is they should be physical operators, so they should be gauge invariant operators acting on the inside links. And with that definition of local measurements or operations, then you can't extract.
What Senthil may be saying is that in the extended Hilbert space, physically you should think of it as having added some charged particles, and then you have these, and then you know you think of the charged particles as being in some sense operators that are inside the region, even though really they have Wilson lines that stretch out to infinity. Is that fair? And therefore you should allow yourself to act with those local operators, even though they have secret.
You have to be very careful because you don't want the charges to cut across, in effect constructing Wilson lines that cut across the region, because then you'll allow the most general non-local operations across the two halves of the bipartite system. And then for every system, you'll get zero entanglement. See, it'll be the analog of this system where you act on both qubits. So if you allow the most general non-local operations, then you'll get zero entanglement for every system. That won't be satisfactory either. So the natural way to think about it is through local operators. And with charged operation, charged matter also, as long as you restrict the charged matter not to cross over, you'll have a similar issue, where all the local operators involving, including charged matter, you can have Wilson lines extending inside which end on charges inside, are not the complete set. And non-abelian, yeah, exactly. And exactly, thank you very much. Yes, exactly right. In non-abelian theories, you'll see there's charged matter. There's an extra term which actually adds to the classical piece, as you'll see. Because there's extra matter, but it must always come paired up because of gauge invariance at vertices. And you'll see that in a minute. So there, certainly, you don't get around it. OK, well, we can talk more about it. Okay, so all right, let me go on just to terminate this. So this is the decomposition. You have super selection sectors that comes in the way of extracting everything. The definition, if you've been reading some of the literature I gave you for the Z2 case, corresponds to what's called the electric center prescription of Cassini, Huerta, and Rosabal in the abelian case. But in the non-abelian case, it's a little different. Let me just quickly tell you about why there is a new feature in the non-abelian case. I won't go into it in great detail. Definition. Cassini, Huerta, and Rosabal thought about it in more algebraic terms, and they thought about this constraint I wrote down in more algebraic terms, which was the Gauss law constraint. So sigma 1, the product of sigma 1 for all the inside loops is, inside links is the product of sigma 1 on all the outside, the Gauss law constraint. And they said, look, this means that if you look at the algebra of gauge invariant operators on the inside, it has a non-trivial center. And that is because the gauge invariant operators on the inside will, of course, commute operators defined on the outside links. But on the subspace of all gauge invariant states, this is actually an operator identity. And therefore, the set of all operators on the inside links must have a non-trivial center. And they said, look, this non-trivial center, in a sense, is a reflection of this fact that the Hilbert space is not decomposing. Once one realizes this, then the resolution becomes clear because you say, okay, let me just diagonalize the center. Once I diagonalize the center, then in each subsector of fixed eigenvalue, then the center becomes a number. And that's as if you had a trivial center. And then you can construct a tensor product. So thinking like this in much more algebraic ways, they came to the same understanding that the Hilbert space can be written as a sum over different sectors. Is the same, exactly the same in the abelian case as what we got. Now, the non-trivial thing here is, it turns out you can make it, you have some choice of how to choose your center. And you might choose your center a little differently. Here I chose it to be the electric flux operators, because Gauss law constraint is natural. And from our point of view, when we think of the extended Hilbert space, that's the natural thing. But sometimes, if you extend your lattice and you choose in a different way and you choose a different center, then it can be a more magnetic choice as opposed to electric choice, and then you can get a somewhat different answer. And then you have to worry whether in the continuum they're all the same or not. And so that's why it's called electric center choice. But this is the basic idea. Okay, sorry. So now, why is there a new feature? That new feature is tied to the fact that irreducible representations in the non-abelian theory have dimension greater than 1, okay? And that fact actually gives rise to an additional contribution to the entanglement. Just to tell you now, suppose you have two vertices, a link variable. The variable now is a SU2 matrix, and you can have a left and a right action of the SU2 gauged of the SU2 symmetry on that matrix. You can think of the left action as the gauge transformation generated at the I vertex, from where the link begins. Now the directionality of the link is important, so it goes from I to J. The left action is the gauge transformation at the I vertex. The right action is the gauge transformation at the J vertex. Okay, and these two don't always commute. Okay, never mind. Other than that, you can set up everything in a very analogous way. I'll skip over some details. Let's now come to the Gauss law constraint. Well, gauge transformation, suppose I take the vertex I, I direct all links going out from it in this way, and label these links as ij. Then gauge invariant states are those which are annihilated by the sum over j aij for all links j leaving this vertex. Okay? So that's the Gauss law constraint. And in particular that... Oh, sorry. Excuse me. I'm sorry. No, I didn't mean left invariant. Excuse me. Left invariant. Sorry. Please excuse me. So now, if I took the in, suppose these two were the in links and those were the out links, then in particular, since the total, if I'm doing SU2, this means the total ingoing angular momentum should equal the net outgoing angular momentum. And a gauge invariant way to say that is that JA square should be the same for each vertex. So that's one constraint you get. But it's more than that, okay? It actually says that the state at each vertex should be a singlet with respect to the total gauge transformation, inside plus outside, okay? So suppose each of these took value J, some value J which is not equal to zero, okay? Then the fact that it's a singlet with respect to that full gauge transformation of the inside and outside, that tells you that there is a non-trivial entanglement of the state inside with the state outside. Because, for example, suppose the net angular momentum of the inside and outside had been half, then the state of this vertex would include a term, to be a little imprecise, include a term which is something like plus, minus, 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 plus, so that you get a net singlet under the total gauge transformation. And half is what is flowing along the diagonal, exactly. So this could be zero, that could be half. Exactly. So if you do that, just because you are in a singlet sector made out of two spin J's or two spin halves for this example, you'll get an extra entanglement, so to say, which is log half. Okay? And in the more general case, log 2J plus 1, just from this fact. Now, if you're not going to be able to do local transformations which change the total electric flux going out, you can't change the total value of J square, and therefore this label J. And if you can't change that, you can't change this entanglement either, because that entanglement always comes along as long as the net entanglement going in is J units and the net going out is J units, and because they have to combine to be a singlet under Gauss law. And that means, to cut a somewhat long story short, when you now work out the entanglement entropy as per this whole extended Hilbert space definition, they turn out to be three terms. Okay, this is just the probability to be in every flux sector, where the flux sector is denoted by the value of the Casimir J square at every vertex. That's the familiar one we had seen in the abelian case. An extra one which comes because you have to combine the angular momentum to be a singlet at each vertex. And this third term, which is the average over each of the sectors using the probability PK. Okay. Here, did I miss out? I think, is there a PK? I think there's a PK, I'm sorry. Yes, this PK outside, this PK times log of this. Yeah, exactly. Just because it should be a singlet, the inside density matrix should be a singlet under gauge transformations at the vertices you can show. You take a equal combination. Exactly. Okay, so that's the answer. And now let me prove by exhaustion stop soon. If you chose some analog of electric center, some other definition, you don't have to get this. You get this term, that term, et cetera, never mind. But this is what you get in the extended Hilbert space. Now, very quickly, 10 minutes, if you'll permit. Okay, thank you. Two reasons to take this definition seriously I'd like to give you. One is that it agrees with the replica trick, or more correctly, the replica trick as defined using a lattice regulator. If you are interested in the final continuum limit, then since we are working with the lattice, using the lattice definition, you can get a lattice replica trick, and this will agree with that. And that is a definition which is intrinsically Euclidean, involving a path integral. So doesn't talk about states, which Hilbert space, you are embedding it, and so on. But this agrees with that. And the other, that if you look at simple systems like toric chords and you extract a physically meaningful part from this entanglement, which is independent of cutoffs, then the answer you get is a useful one. In the toric chord, there's a good reason to believe that the topological entanglement entropy should be tied to properties of the anionic excitations, the total quantum dimension, and so on. And this definition gives you an answer which agrees with that. Okay, so it seems. That's right. So the answer, which independent of cutoff and so on, the universal part agrees with that. Exactly. Okay. So just very quickly, why does it agree with the replica trick? You know, in the replica trick, what one does is to first try to compute trace rho to the n through a path integral, then take a suitable limit to compute rho log rho. And the way you compute rho to the n is that you first basically construct the state at some instant of time by doing the path integral from minus infinity to that instant of time. And then you, I haven't done this, and then you construct, so that gives you, if you like, that the path integral from minus infinity up to here gives you psi. Then you do the path integral from plus infinity to give you, this is the bra and this is the ket. And then you want to compute the density matrix. And so what you do to compute the density matrix is that you identify, you trace over the region not of interest. So if the region of interest, if I'm just interested in one dimension to keep things simple, is this strip, then what you do is you identify the region outside here with here. I'm sorry, the region here with the region here and the region here with the region here. But you're careful in identifying regions along the strip of interest, you're careful about how you identify things, and you identify the configuration below here with the configuration above here, and the configuration below here with the region above here to compute, for example, rho square. And if you wanted to do it for rho cube, you would have three sheets, and then you'd make the identification by going three times around, so to say, and so on. Okay, so you have to work in this way on a suitable cover of R2, say, if you're doing a 1 plus 1D case, R3 if it's a 2 plus 1D case, and so on. But you basically do the path integral like that. And when you do the path integral, you basically sum over all configurations. Okay, this is the essential point. On the lattice, if you're doing it in the Hamiltonian framework, no further gauge fixing is needed. These variables are all compact variables. If you have a compact group, SU2, U1. So the path integral is completely well-defined without any gauge fixing. You simply sum over all configurations. Now, because you sum over all configurations, when you now think about the path integral in terms of a Hilbert space interpretation by introducing complete states, then the natural Hilbert space in which, you know, the states lie as you slice the path integral is the extended Hilbert space. Okay, I'm going over this a little bit quickly. So, yeah, you could say, well, you happen to have chosen one definition of the replica trick. You know, somebody else could choose another. But this is sort of a very natural way you would define the replica trick on the lattice. And if starting from here, you can go to the continuum in the usual way in which you go in lattice gauge theory, then you should get the normal continuum replica trick definition. Yeah. This may count some additional degrees of freedom, but hopefully by the time you go to the continuum where you'll have to gauge fix, if you've done that gauge fix, so starting from the lattice where you don't have to gauge fix, you should be able to go to the continuum where you now have to gauge fix. And if you do that correctly, then the two gauge fix versions should be agreeing with each other. So that is the hope, but that remains to be shown. That remains to be shown. That's right. Okay, so this underlying fact that that each link is naturally appears to be an independent variable, naturally appears as an independent variable, means that at least this definition then agrees with the extended Hilbert space definition we use. Okay, so I went over that a little bit quickly. I can go over it more, but there's a natural replica trick interpretation for this definition. Okay. that's true. I bought in an action, and that's exactly right. But I'm saying in cases where an action can be defined, for example, in the Z2 theory or the U1, there's a very natural action you can write down. And in those cases, you can then try, you can also try to just give a definition using a more Euclidean method. And that would agree as per this. That's right. You, if you change the action, what you'll change is your notion of the ground state. And then for that ground state, when you compute the entanglement using the replica trick, it would agree with what you would get for that state using the extended Hilbert space. That would be. We'll change the PKs and also the second term. The P. Exactly, exactly. Okay, remaining 5 minutes, just the toric code, because it's a very nice, simple physical example. Here's the Hamiltonian for the toric code. You have a plaquette term, which is familiar to all of you who do lattice gauge theory, where these variables, just for simplicity, we can take the Z2 case, although you can define it also for a discrete non-abelian group. But anyway, take the Z2 case, you have the plaquette term over the elementary plaquette, okay, in the theory, the simplest square, which you weight with C1, which is positive. And then there's an interesting additional term, which is made out of terms defined at every vertex, and this operator G is simply the operator we defined before, which imposes gauge invariance. Okay, and so by definition, to begin with, this is the nice thing. You see, once you're on the lattice and you gauge fix so that A0 is zero, the temporal component of the gauge field is zero, then you already have a unitary Hilbert space. So you don't have to impose gauge invariance as an absolute condition. And here, what you do. Is that right? If you add matter, yes, and you. Gauge fixed, I see. OK. Not integrated out, but. And they don't fluctuate or something. Yeah. I see. OK. In a particular gauge, then you don't have gauge invariance anymore, I guess. Okay, you could make these two, all these also transform suitably, and then. Okay. So this could. What I meant was, this Hamiltonian by itself is not gauge invariant, is gauge invariant to begin with, because these are gauge invariant and these are also gauge invariant. But you can choose to also allow states, which are non-gauge invariant, in the spectrum. At a cost in price, which comes because of this coefficient C2. Okay, then the additional states which are not gauge invariant, where you're paying this price in energy, you might say are gauge invariant if you allow additional transformations. Actually, this term by itself is gauge invariant. Of the constraint, of the you could if you. You could interpret it like that. You could interpret it like that. Alternatively, you could just say, look, here's a theory. To begin with, I don't run into problems that I might sometimes in the continuum if you had a gauge theory and you allowed gauge non-invariant states and so on. I don't run into that problem as far as unitarity and so on is concerned. I just pay a price in energy. So I can think of relaxing the constraint. Okay. Yeah. Yeah. To correctly quantize that theory, I think you'll have to add the source of the violation and quantize that as well. Otherwise, you won't be able to do it. In this interpretation? Yeah. So, yeah, in general, what you say is correct. What will happen here is when I go to the, if both of these coefficients are positive and you go to the ground state, both these operators both commute with each other because this imposes gauge invariance, and this is the usual Plekett operator, which is gauge invariance. So they commute with each other. So the ground state is where both of these individually have their minimum value. Namely, each Plekett is plus one. So what will actually happen in the ground state is that the ground state will be gauge invariant by itself, and it will meet a particular value for the Plekett operator. So, but I bring this up for the following reason. To begin with, conceptually, you need not have had gauge invariance imposed as an absolute requirement. You could choose to think of this Hamiltonian in the extended Hilbert space as a natural setting or definition for it. And that makes it clear that the definition. So for C2 not equal to infinity, the natural Hilbert space to work in would have been the extended Hilbert space. Okay, and so if I took then the ground state of this Hamiltonian, which happens to be gauge invariant, then I wanted to attribute an entanglement to that ground state, then the natural way to do it would have been to work in the extended Hilbert space and say, this is the entanglement I associate with it. Now, if you're really interested in the gauge theory, then we could go to the C2 going to infinity limit from there. And it could be that there is a kind of phase transition as you go to that limit. Okay? And if that happened, then you might be worried that the definition you've given for the case in the extended Hilbert space definition, maybe it doesn't directly apply in the gauge theory. But actually what happens is this system is well known to be gapped. And for that gap to, in fact, it's one of these topological phases. And for that gap to persist as you go to C2 going to infinity. So the limit where you go to the case where gauge invariance then becomes, where it becomes a gauge theory, where the Hilbert space truncates for all finite energies to gauge invariant states, that limit is non-singular. And that suggests that the entanglement you define in the extended Hilbert space should give you the correct definition for the gauge invariant case as well. So I just brought this up as a physical example where you have a Hamiltonian and so on, where again, from physics considerations, you think that this extended Hilbert space definition is a sensible one to give. And just to add to that, I don't have it, I'm sorry, here for some reason. But if you compute the entanglement in this case, then as is well known, let's say I take some region of interest, and it has some boundary L, number of boundary links, then the entanglement entropy for the Z2 case is something like log 2 times the length of the boundary minus 1. This minus 1 is simply because there's a constraint that the product over every elementary Plekett is 1, so over the entire Wilson loop bounding the region is also 1. That one constraint results in the minus 1. And that means when you define a kind of finite contribution by removing the infinite terms, you can do this by defining what's called the topological entanglement entropy. Then the topological entanglement entropy is it plus log 2 or minus log 2? I don't remember. Minus log 2. Yeah, is minus log 2. So there's a finite piece which you can define in an unambiguous way. And that finite piece is tied to properties of anions and the total quantum dimension and so on. And you get that finite piece correctly by working in the extended Hilbert space. And that's to be expected because the natural definition automatically is in the extended Hilbert space. But so that is expected. But from the point of view of our discussion, the interesting thing is the following. We had this definition which had the PK log PK term, which I said you can't extract, and the other piece which is extractable. And in the abelian case, you can ask which of those two terms contributes. The one which just gives you the classical probability to be in different flux sectors, or the other one. And the answer is, for the Z2 case, the entire contribution comes from the pk log pk term. Okay. So if you were to sort of throw that away, you wouldn't get the right answer, right, in the sense that it's giving you properties about the anions and so on. And in the non-abelian case, if you do this, then you find all three terms in general contribute, the pk log pk, pk log 2j plus 1, and the third term. If you throw any one of them away, in general, you'll not get the quote-unquote right answer corresponding to properties of anions and so on. So what that says is that working in the extended Hilbert space makes sense in several physical cases. And also, working in that and giving this definition, keeping all three terms gives you a physically reasonable answer. Okay. So that's what I wanted to say. And then the last thing, and then I'll stop, is I'll only say it in words, is that because these labels of the different sectors correspond to electric fluxes or the entanglement of two spin J's, which are in a entangled trivial state in terms of SU2, because of these things which you can't change by local operations, the entanglement we define does not agree with the amount of entanglement you can extract as per standard protocols of entanglement distillation and dilution that quantum information people talk about. And just to tell you in words, what they do here is the following. In distillation, for example, what they do is the following, and then I'll stop. You have a bipartite system, so two parts, there's some entanglement, you want to measure it. You say, I'll allow local operations on either A or B, and I will take some set of unentangled qubits, okay? So completely, just a bunch of electrons, if you like, totally unentangled. Then I'll do some local operations which will work on either A or on this set of the unentangled qubits, N of them, or B and the remaining set of unentangled qubits. And at the end of the day, what I'll try to do is go to a situation where A and B are totally unentangled or as little entangled as I can make them, and the 2N qubits are as entangled as they can be. That is, this set N is as entangled with the set N as they can be. Okay, I'll try to transfer the entanglement to some reference system, and then I'll just measure the number of entangled qubits I produce, the number of entangled Bell pairs I produce. If I produce N Bell pairs, I'll say the entanglement to begin with was N. Okay, so it's a little bit like you use a kilogram as a reference, here you use Bell pairs as a reference, convert entanglement into the reference system of Bell pairs, and then check how many Bell pairs you produce. So that's the basic idea. And for the reason I mentioned that gauge local, that local physical gauge invariant operations can't change sectors, here you find you can't extract the full entanglement. How much can you extract? And in a, we made this very precise. Sorry. That's right. Yes. That's right. You have an auxiliary system, and the purpose of the auxiliary system is you know how to count entanglement as per your definition in the auxiliary system. So if you have one Bell pair, you say that's one unit of entanglement. Exactly. And the questions do with local unitary operations, local operations, generalized. Cannot be extracted, exactly. And the non-trivial thing was to prove that, all right, physically you might expect that you can't extract this. Sorry, there's a PK here, I apologize. But the slightly non-trivial thing was to prove whether you can extract all of this, and the answer which we gave in this recent paper is that explicitly showed that that third term can be extracted, all of it, by these operations. Both, you have to do distillation, and there's also something called dilution, and then you get the bound that you can extract this and all of it in some asymptotic sense. You have to do this by taking N copies of the system and so on, put in the epsilons and deltas, and there's a story here, but ultimately that's what you get. Okay, so let me end. We proposed a definition for entanglement. Is not extractable. Not extractable. So I don't know fully what to make of it. It's clearly physical, it measures physical properties, but it's not extractable as per this definition, as per this way of trying to quantify things. So, okay, that's. Yeah, it might be that in cases where it's all sort of long range, you need both parts of the system, otherwise you can't access this. Okay, so we proposed a definition. It's applicable quite generally to abelian, non-abelian, also theories with matter. It has many nice properties. It's gauge invariant. It agrees with at least a definition of the replica trick. Does not agree with an operational definition based on dilution or distillation. And on this day when we celebrate the foundation day of ICTS, let's hope that the entanglement among scientists that ICTS produces, even in this workshop, will lead to a deeper understanding of entanglement and all the other mysteries of the universe. Thank you. Here's the root system of this giant banyan tree we have in TIFR. It's pretty entangled. Anyway, thank you. Sorry to go way over time. But.
Okay, so I think we have time for some questions. Yes.
Yeah. Oh, please, yeah.
Just what I think Subir was beginning to say, but you know, so let's define the rules of the game, right? So what we would define as the rules of the game, we start with a lattice system of, let's say, bosons or fermions or spins or something. For concreteness, let's say bosons, right? So also spin system. This obviously has a tensor product description, right? And there's some Hamiltonian that you place on the Hilbert space. And this Hamiltonian can, depending on parameters in the Hamiltonian, can be in one of many faces. It'll have a phase diagram. Now, depending on the Hamiltonian, you could be in a phase in which the low energy physics is described by a gauge theory. Right? And then you can ask about what is it about the ground state wave function when the system is in this phase that distinguishes the wave function from what it is in some other phase. Right? And the distinction is not an order parameter distinction. Right? So there's something else that distinguishes the two ground state wave functions. Mm-hmm. And the expectation is that the structure of entanglement in the ground state wave function is different. Mm. Right? Now, of course, there's no problem with defining the entanglement, entropy or anything, because we always work only with things that have tensor product descriptions. But then the question to ask is there universal structure in the entanglement entropy or mm-hmm. other entanglement structure that will show up as the difference?
Right.
So then in that case, it's in this topological order, it's the topological entanglement mm-hmm. entropy. Mm-hmm. Or if you have a U1 gauge theory, that's an analogous mm-hmm. piece. The non-abelian case, you said you're talking about a C2 gauge theories. I don't quite know what to make of it because there's no deconfined phase for the C2 gauge theory. So the long distance entanglement entropy would just be.
Well, you know, for the non-abelian toric chords, there is an analog of a deconfined.
That's discrete
non-abelian. Oh, yeah. Did you say? I see. Mm-hmm.
But in the continuum, I don't know what to say. You could have
John Simon's theory,
then it
for example.
Logical.
Yeah, but it's actually an interesting question, which I haven't. The calculations for Chern Simons have been done,
yeah.
Of course. And even in Kitaev and Preskill and so on. But I haven't decomposed them into different flux sectors yet. And I suspect that, again, these topological terms are the main contributors there. And sorry.
Kind of lattice gauge series you're talking about. If you take the SU2 gauge theory and take the continuum limit, it's just confined. So then there's nothing universal about the entanglement.
Yeah, there's nothing universal about it, but I don't know. But, you know, maybe you can have, we know non-abelian gauge theories in, say, particle physics, supersymmetric ones, for example, which are in deconfined phases,
right.
And with enough matter. And there, you know, this can, maybe there's a topological piece. For example, to come to something, suppose you had a conformal field theory, which is non-abelian with matter, then you might expect that there are universal pieces, logarithmic pieces, and so on. And then it's an interesting game, even for U1, but certainly in the non-abelian case as well, what picks up the coefficient of the logarithm? You know, is it the full answer? Is it the extractable piece? Is it the extended Hilbert space definition, et cetera? In some cases, in some cases people say just the anomaly gets it right, but then maybe there are subtleties to it. So it is.
Are they lattice-sizable?
This is the point is that they are well-defined field theories.
I don't know if that's a word, but you know.
Yeah. I don't know if they're latticizable, but you know, the question of if you have a well-defined field theory, is there a universal part to the entanglement and what is it? Is a well-defined question just for a continuum field theorist. And actually, some of these, I suspect some of these supersymmetric theories are latticizable because they're not chiral. And you'll break some of the supersymmetries just as you break some of the translational and Lorentz symmetries, but they're latticizable in the sense that you can write down a Hamiltonian or Lagrangian whose continuum limit you hope will recover all those symmetries. So I think with hypermultiplets and so on, you should be able to construct such examples. But just in the to rephrase your question, which is a very good one, I think is a very good one for me too, let's suppose we had a theory which to begin with in the ultraviolet is not a gauge theory, it's a spin system. None of these issues are there. Now it flows to a gauge theory in the infrared. We have some unambiguous definition of entanglement. From the low energy viewpoint of the gauge theory, how would you calculate it? That would be a calculation which would be in universal terms. What would get it right? And, at least in some physical situations, the definition I'm giving, I think, gets it right. Does it get it right in all cases? I don't know. But I think if what I would suspect is that if there is a final continuum version in terms of a field theory, which lends itself to a replica trick, et cetera, then I think the continuum path, the finite path should come out right as per this definition. That is what I'm trying to suggest. And then this question remains in general that this answer will not be what a quantum information theorist would say is extractable. And whereas for a spin system, don't get me on the dualities, perhaps it would all be extractable. And that's an interesting question that perhaps you could think about.
Other questions? People are all very tired.
Yeah, sorry.
Okay, if not, so I think let's thank Sandip once more. Thank you.
Let's thank Professor Ashok Sen, the chair of the session.